that he is involved in this kind of nefarious activity, which may not be any. So this is what is the most worrying part, that if US, and there is nothing to suggest that the US or any other country for that matter would not make use of it in this manner.
Right.
They would want to have a person who is totally friendly to them, and an inconvenient Castro if attempts were made to get rid of him. Now there could be more sophisticated ways of getting rid of the person from the power, and which is much easier in a democratic country, where you do it in a country like
paralysis by analysis. And this happened to the CIA even at the time of the Shah of Iran. If any common person in Iran could tell you that the Shah of Iran is going to be toppled, and the CIA didn't know that. They gathered all the information, but they could not say, answer the simple question, will the Shah, can the Shah stay or will he be toppled? Now this is what has happened. This is what has happened also when why 9/11 couldn't be prevented, is that they had so much information but they couldn't connect the dots. So what actually is, you know, intelligence have to, agents have to do is triage. They have to say what is valid information and what is invalid information. Now what terrorists are actually kind of getting onto this weakness is that they overwhelm their, the kind of intelligence agencies with so much data, chatter, that the agency cannot say what is the significant conversation and what is the insignificant conversation. So they're not able to make sense of a conversation and figure out what's important and where an attack is going to happen, when and where an attack is going to happen, because they diverted with 15.
You need a whistleblower like a Snowden, who draws attention to the enormity of what the state is doing. And this is the challenge that President Obama and his team are now facing. The world is, the United States has now accreted so much power, and we are not sure that they use it in the right way. And then you come back to the Iraq war and, you know, the way in which they went about. So that is, I think, causing this deep anxiety about the United States.
Okay, Mr. Sharma.
It also brings out a tool, since Commodore rightly mentioned the HR aspect. You have in every organization people keeping tab, and somewhere that system of the US failed in this case. So it's a more complex issue of HR than we think, and I'm sure that it will lead to a lot of reworking of the system from an outsourced company. And whether you can within 2 years trust an outsourced company person so much that he has such extraordinary access is another issue.
Right, so clearly they it may not prevent them from doing it in the future, but certainly it has caused them a lot of embarrassment, these revelations by Edward Snowden. But the point that Commodore Bhaskar made, Mr. Sharma, is it alarming that that, you know, the US is doing it on such a massive scale? To Insight, we are talking about the allegations of the extent of spying by the US, which has shocked citizens and countries across the world. Mr. Prasad, I'll continue with you. Now, there's now a fear that, you know, other governments, other countries may follow what the U.S. is doing, may pick up from the from what the National Security Agency has been doing. Do you see that happening? Because in the Indian context, we understand India has launched its own version of the PRISM program.
Well, certainly. See, all intelligence agencies do this from all countries. Now, you have to accept that.
It is, you know, this has triggered a whole debate on whether freedom, individual freedom of privacy, should be compromised in the name of security. Should governments be allowed to snoop into people's Facebook accounts or their Google searches or their emails and texts, all in the name of security?
You see, if you want security, there has to be a some degree of compromise. The challenge is only that that compromise does not exceed a limit, and that it is not abused or misused, as Commodore was saying also earlier, that there is a system that the citizen is protected from its abuse or misuse, but it can't
be safety and security of your citizens. So therefore state accords unto itself certain powers and certain rights. And I think if you look at the whole theory of state and how governments are formed, it's very important to maintain this balance that the state, and I come back to this point about the rectitude of state, meaning there is power inherent, you know, between say the father and the rest of the family or in a gender context. The challenge is to ensure that you use your power in the right way, quote unquote. And the right way is to ensure that there is always the equivalent of the collective interest and the individual interest.
Right.
So when President Obama says that it's important to find this balance between in which you acquire capacity,
right,
but you use it within a certain framework.
Okay.
Whether that will happen is a question.
Okay, we shall take that point further as well. But do citizens really have a choice in this matter?
Who know, those who have the technological, shall we say, awareness to frankly institute this. Otherwise, we give unto state certain powers, cyber command, that they have appropriated certain rights and certain capabilities that are beyond scrutiny. That is cause for concern. So citizens of the world, frankly, sit up and take note.
Right, because Mr. Prasad, in this age of electronic communication, anything we write on the internet can be the subject of somebody snooping. What choice do we really have then?
Well, it's very difficult. See, first of all, you have to give up all expectations of privacy or security. You have to assume that if you're going to send an email, if you're going to do send a message to anyone, you are sending a postcard.
We'll be back with the final segment of the show. Welcome back to Insight. We are discussing the controversy surrounding the spying program of the United States and its implications. Commodore Bhaskar, as we grapple with security concerns today, how well are we prepared to tackle the cyber threat according to you?
Well, I think if you look at it in a global context, I would submit that India's cyber capabilities are reasonable. We clearly are not at the same level as the United States because much of this is also driven by resources, both material and human. And India does not have the same level to invest at this point in terms of cyber. India, I would just make the point that it's reasonable, but we need to frankly invest more and we need to acquire a higher quality in terms of our overall, I would say, cyber capability. And the reason is that India is becoming increasingly cyber dependent. If you look at India's base of one greater penetration of the computer, so I think for India, the need to invest in this in a very focused way is it's like no rocket science. It's so obvious to me. The second is, I think we have to look at regulation, both within India, meaning we are now talking about the CMS. Because for India, as a security analyst, I would make a very strong case to say that we have to allow the state to have the ability to carry out this kind of quote-unquote snooping because of the kind of low-intensity conflict, terrorism, and all these issues that the state has to deal with. Therefore, we need to get our legislation in place that you equip the state oversight. Today, the executive in India has too much power. This is my personal reading. There is inadequate parliamentary and, in a way, I would say, even the citizen. I see no reason why you cannot have a group of eminent persons whose integrity is beyond reproach and who provide a kind of ombudsman, you know, kind of role. Concurrently, I believe India should also pitch at the global level. Today, the world is evolving cyber norms. It's all being driven by the United States. To an extent, it's being driven by the market, you know, big groups like Google. We have not positioned ourselves, I think, appropriately to be part of the management. So, no moan and groan, acquire your capacity, acquire your political determination and weight